When you say Alhamdulillah, it is a status of praise, because the one who granted you everything is to be praised regardless of the blessing. His entity, subhanahu wa ta'ala, his might, is of all might and praise, that everything should be in stance of Alhamd. So you are focusing on Allah, you are not focusing on the ni'mah itself. So that's just a hint to remember the difference, why it is Alhamdulillah as the beginning of the Fatiha, not Ash-Shukrulillah. So everyone will be focusing on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then when we say Wassalatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah, we are responding to the order from Allah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ay inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Allah and His men and His angels are making salat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, me and you and everyone, sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Make salat and salam on him in the status of taslim, and we'll take each one. Now, if you know Arabic language, the order sallu alayhi, sallu, the waw is you. You should make salat on the Prophet. So if you're going to go literal meaning, you should say, I make salam on the Prophet. Ana usalli alayhi. But that's not what we do. What do we do when we make salam and salam on the Prophet? What do we say? Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. We don't make the salam on the Prophet ourselves. We make it a dua. We make it a prayer to Allah. Ya Rabb, send your prayers on your Prophet. Why? Because no one can give the Prophet his proper salah and taslim but Allah. Who am I and who you are to be in which status to give him salah and salam? You can only make dua to Allah, so He, the Almighty, that already started by making salah on him, that you ask him to make salam and salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you say, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ala Sayyidina Muhammad, you know, kama sallayta ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ala Sayyidina Ibrahim. Now, most of the people, when we ask you, what does a salah from Allah on the Prophet means? Any ideas? Ar-Rahman. That's the most famous, translation or interpretation. But we have an ayah in the Quran that says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة. We have an ayah that brings the term الصلاة and الرحمة with واو العطف. And Arabic language, where you say واو العطف تقتضي التغاير, it means two meanings are separate, they are not the same. So for sure, الصلاة is different than mercy. The most popular, interpretation that Allah is making salah on the Prophet ﷺ, meaning having mercy on him. But according to this ayah, as-salah is different than what? Than the mercy that is being by default given to the Prophet ﷺ. So as-salah on the Prophet from Allah means a type of praise fil mala'i al-a'la, naw'un min al-thana, that we don't know. Abu al-Aliya, one of the tabi'een, says, هو وصف للنبي أمام الملائكة. He says Allah describes His Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to His angels. That's how He makes salah on them. Regardless what it is in the term of the ghaib. We don't know exactly how Allah سبحانه وتعالى makes salah on His Prophet, but it is a type of thana. It is a type of praise that Allah is making what? On the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And many people, whenever they need to remember that if the name of the Prophet is mentioned, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you should always answer as Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا. You must always bring as-salam on the Prophet too, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَسَلِّمُوا, send your salams. So when you say, اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم, as if you are saying, As-salamu alayk, as if you are sending him an actual salam. And what is as-salam? What is as-salam? Huh? It is one of the names of Allah. As-salam al-mu'min al-muhaymin al-aziz al-jabbar al-minum. And the ayah, Surah Al-Hashr. I'll get the ayah now. So, what you are saying when you're saying As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabi or Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad, I am making the term Allah as-salam to care for his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is towards you, protecting you, guarding you, caring for you, O Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu. So all that you need to think of only when you say Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is just the introduction for the khatibah tonight. So, cultivating taqwa. When we are talking about cultivating taqwa, the purpose behind our creation is what? Who knows? What is the purpose of our creation? Ibadatullah. Anyone knows the verse in the Quran? In Surah Al-Dhariyat. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created jinn nor ins but to what? To worship me. That's who's talking, Allah. If our purpose is to worship Allah, what is the purpose of worshiping Allah? Any ideas?
Ikhlas?
No, that's one of the conditions.
Praising Allah.
Be obedient. Okay. Good. All good answers, mashallah. In our creed, in our aqidah, we believe that Allah is al-ghani, the all-sufficient. Right? Which means لا تنفعه طاعة ولا تضره معصية. He is not to benefit from us in any way, nor he would be defected by us in any way. Right? That's his might. He's God. He doesn't need us. Actually, in the hadith al-Qudusi, in the holy hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لو أن أولكم وآخركم إنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أتقى قلب رجل واحد منكم ما زاد في ملك شيئا. If the beginning and the end of humanity, ins and jinn, they were all like on the level of faith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will not add to his mind one inch. ولو أن أولكم وآخركم إنسكم وجنكم كانوا على أفجر قلب رجل واحد منكم. If every single person in humanity came was kafir, Allah will not be affected. So what is the purpose of me worshipping God if he's not going to be affected? So I'm praying to God, but he doesn't need my prayer. I'm fasting to God, but he doesn't need my fasting. The recipient is you, it's not Allah. And that's the term that when you worship Allah, it comes back that it's going to be cashing back a quality life for you as a human being. And this is the term where the taqwa comes in. The original name of taqwa from the Arabic language is from waqayaqi, to put a preventive measure, a barrier between you and something else. So when you say ittaqillah or taqwa Allah, putting barrier of what? Through your ibadah, through your fasting, through your salah, through your hajj, through your zakah, through your honesty, trustworthiness, being righteous with your parents, you are praising Allah, or you are raising all these acts of worship toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not that because he needs it, he doesn't need it, but because he's gonna make that come back to you as a community, as family, as individuals, and do what? And cash it in quality life among each other. That's how we understand, for example, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. That the outcome of salah, it's not really is gonna God benefit from it. The outcome of salah, when you do it sincerely, back to the condition that the sister mentioned, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you are going to benefit from a salah. It's gonna prevent you from causing harm to others. When the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ فِيهِ حَاجَةً أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. If you do not start making false statements and accusations on people, don't fast. Because fasting, if you are able to quit food and water and intimacy from dawn till sunset, then you should be able to quit harming people. So this is how the idea of taqwa, putting a barrier between you and other people, that you don't cause yourself harm, you don't cause people around you harm, starting from family. Even if there were enemies, it has conditions and guidelines. Now this is mentioned in the origin of the creation. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Shams. Who knows Surah Al-Shams? Starts by what? Wash-shamsi. What's waw here? Anyone knows in the Arabic language what's the waw? Waw al-qasr, an oath. Who's making the oath? Allah. Allah is making an oath by Al-Shams. Wash-shamsi wa duhaha, by the sun and the way it rises up. Wal-qamari, by the moon. By wal-shamsi wa duhaha, wal-qamari idha tila, if it follows it. Wal-layli idha yakshaha, the night if it follows. Wal-nahari idha jallaha, by the day that it brought it up. Wal-samai wa mabanaha, by the heavens of how he made it perfect. وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَطَحَهَا, by the land of how he spread it. And then what? وَنَفْسٍ وَمَسَرُ. Do you see a difference between everything else and nafs? What is the difference between everything mentioned and a nafs? Anyone pays attention? وَالشَّمْسِ وَالْقَمَرِ وَاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَنَفْسِ. There is no al-ta'rif. There is no the nafs. It is nafs. Everything else is identified. Everything else is identified except who? Me and you. Nafs. Open. We call it in Arabic nakira, unknown. Why? Because everything else is abstract, jamal. It does not have a conscience. It does not choose. It does not have free will. Except me and you, we have what? Free will. We choose. So Allah is saying, everything else is in a status of taslim lillah, submission and surrender, abstract, general am. Except you and me, you decide how do you want to identify yourself. And that's exactly what the verses right after this verse says. By what? وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا. This is how we call, this is النفس الملهمة. The nafs that has been inspired originally through creation to be able to encounter what is good or what is evil. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. He gave her the ability to do fujur and to do what? Taqwa. So the opposite of fujur, Allah used the term what? Taqwa, back to the term that we are talking about today. That through the idea of preventing harm on yourself, on others, that is the core purpose of your presence on earth. And this is your job. By the concept of التزكية, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. He is triumph, he is a winning person, one who purified it. مِنْ زَكَى يَزْكُ, to purify. وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا, a failure. He is the one who put it, you know, under the carpet of تزكية, or you know, righteousness. But is this the only type of soul or nafs or spirit that Allah spoke about? There are five types of nufus Allah mentioned. The first one is an-nafs al-mulhama from this surah. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. There is another type of nafs called an-nafs al-zakiyya. Who knows where is this mentioned in the Quran? Allah gave us a term, nafs zakiya. It is mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf, in the story of Musa and Al-Khadr alayhi salam. When Musa, part of the wisdom of Allah, killed one of the children, right? What did Al-Khadr killed him? What did Musa tell Al-Khadr? أَقَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا زَكِيَّةً بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ. How could you have killed a pure soul? Why? Because we believe that children under puberty are not liable for their deeds in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the Day of Judgment. Which means here that this nafs is in a status of purity, as the Prophet said, يُولَدُ الْمَوْلُودُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ. That everyone is created on the status of purity, the natural inclination, the natural composition that Allah made us able. Which means that you have all these years, you have your fitrah, your natural inclination. You have the years that you are growing up on themes and values that should feed into your what? Into your taqwa. That should feed into your idea of praising good in you versus the ability of doing bad. Now this ability of tazkiyah, nafs zakiyah, is encountered by also the ability to do bad, and that's which Allah called an-nafsul ammaratu bis-su. And where is this term being mentioned? In which surah?
Yusuf.
In Surah Yusuf. وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ. And the term أَمَّارَة is, many people try to understand it as it forces you. No. Even when we say we are the ummah of الْأَمْرِ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ and النَّهِي عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, it's not about we force people بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. No. You know, Quraysh, whenever they wanted to attack the character of the Prophet ﷺ, they could not dare to mention his family. Like, he comes from Quraysh, he comes from Bani Hashim, right? So when they want to attack his character, they will relate him to his mother, Halima Sa'diyah, the one who nursed him. Right? Because he was her son, Rida'a. So one of the people of Quraysh, when he wanted to attack the character of the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? He said, لَقَدْ أَمِرَ أَمْرُ بْنُ أَبِي كَبْشَ. Abu Kabsha is the husband of Halim. Right? So this person saying, the matter of Muhammad grew big, went high, it rose up. لَقَدْ أَمِرَ means went high, grew big. أَمْرُ the matter, Ibn Abi Kabsha to the Prophet ﷺ, which means the term Amara Ya'uru can also mean something to be brought up high and praised. So Al-Ammara Bissu means it praises the Su. It brings up the idea of Fusuq and Fujur and evil high in your nafs. And you make the choice. Even a shaitan cannot force you to do the haram or the evil. Da'awtukum fastajabtum li. I told you, and then you did it on your own. So this nafs of you, تُعَظِّمُ الْمُنْكَرَ تُعَظِّمُ السُّوءِ. It brings up a suit and rise. It makes it look beautiful. It deceives you in that in which it describes the evil or the su'an. Now, these are the two abilities, nafs zakiyah and nafs ammara bis-su'. You have both. You have the zakiyah originally, يُولَدُ الْمَوْلُودُ عَلَى الْفِطْرَةِ, that can kick التَّقْوَى into you. And you have الْأَمْرُ بِالسُّوءِ وَالْأَمَّارَ بِالسُّوءِ, that it keeps praising what? السُّوءِ, anything evil in general. But then, if you win, and if you control this ability of taking decisions in haram, but you rather take decisions in halal, and that which praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you are on the level of النَّفْسُ Al-Lawwama, and which is mentioned in Surah what? Al-Qiyamah. La uqsimu biyawm al-Qiyamah, wa la uqsimu bin nafsi al-Lawwama. The one that blames. If you make a sin, and we will make sins. No one in this hall, no one around the world is pure from sins, except the Prophet ﷺ. Kullu ibn Adam khata'. Every son of Adam is vulnerable to making sins. The problem is not by making sins, it's by continuing without repenting. Allah gave the ability to repent. So allow to blame, the Prophet said in a hadith sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an-nadamu tawbah. Remorse, feeling sorry, or you know, saying sorry, or feeling that, it is a sort of tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So allow, or an-nafsu al-lawwama, is the nafs that keeps what? Blaming itself when you fall into sin. Right? طيب, what is the most famous term we use when you do a sin? What do you do? What do you say? Astaghfirullah. What is the Prophet? What did the Prophet teach us? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first thing we say after we finish salah. Astaghfirullah. But did you do a sin? If astaghfirullah is seen that you only, but I just finished prayer and I'm told to say the first thing three times, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, that's the first thing you say. Salaam alaikum rahmatullah, salaam alaikum rahmatullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. This is the first thing you say. Al-lawama is not just blaming yourself, an-nafs al-lawama, for doing sins by saying astaghfirullah. You do astaghfirullah and you blame yourself that did I do the good deed in proper way? And maybe I did not perform my salah properly. Maybe I was thinking about the food that's gonna be served today. You know, maybe I'm thinking about the business that I have to meet someone. Maybe I'm thinking about that, I'm thinking about this. So you don't just blame yourself on the sins that you do, you blame yourself even on the good deeds. Did you do them properly or you did not? Okay, take it another level. When the Prophet speaks about himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ فِي الْيَوْمِ مِئَةَ مَرَّةِ, I make istighfar for Allah 100 times a day. And he is the one who, if anyone is going to perform any act perfectly, it would be who? The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why he would make istighfar? It is exactly as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha told him, your feet are getting swollen from standing up in salah and ibadah and dhikr. Take it easy on yourself. Especially that Allah forgave that which has been past and future. غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. What did the Prophet reply back, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? قَالَ أَفَلَ أَكُونَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. It is not al-istighfar only in the status of being sinful. It is not astaghfirullah only in the status of perfecting what you are doing. It is the status of just being praising Allah for what He has given you. That I am in the status of shukr by making istighfar. And as the Prophet ﷺ told, مَنْ لَزِمَ الْإِسْتِغْفَارِ, one who keeps, there's two things you need to keep doing. Making astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah as many times as you can, and making salat and salam on the Prophet as much as you can. If you keep making istighfar, جعل الله له من كل هم فرجا. Allah will find you an exit from every problem that you face. And if you keep making salam on the Prophet والسلام, what do you get out of that? You know that you get, you know, the Prophet will reply back to you, صلى عليه واحد صلى الله عليه عشرة. But let's talk language of what it will cash for you in this life too. A person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, inni ad'u, I make dua. Fakam inni usalli, he said, inni usalli like inni ad'u, meaning inni making dua. Fakam aj'alu laka min salati, how much should I make of my dua, of my salah unto you? I want to say, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad like few times. How much should I make that percentage from what I make of dua? Qala mashi, as much as you want. He said, how about one quarter? If I'm gonna do it for, let us say, 10 minutes, let me put 2.5 minutes dua for you and the 7.5 minutes for myself. He said, that's good. And if you increase, it will be better. He said, how about 1/3 for you, 2/3 for me? He said, that's good. And if you increase, it's better. Imagine now, he's gonna do 1/3 just Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad versus Allahumma ghfirli warhamni, you know, for yourself.
He said, how about I'll make half for you, half for me? He said, that's good. And if you increase, it's better. He said, two-thirds for you, one-third for me. He said, it's good. And if you increase, it's better. قَالَ أَجْعَلُ لَكَ صَلَاتِ كُلَّهَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ Then I will not pray for myself. I will just sit down and make salam on you. قَالَ يُغْفَرُ ذَنْبُكَ وَيُفْرَجُ هَمُّكَ Then your sins will be forgiven and your worries will go away. This is the barakah of making salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this nafs al-lawwama, back to the nafs al-lawwama, it is the nafs that blames itself for sinning, for not perfecting an act, for a status of shukr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cultivate that, you come out with the highest level of nafs, which is called an-nafsul mutma'innah, which is mentioned in Surah what? Surah Al-Fajr, Jazakallah khair. Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul mutma'innah, O soul of tranquility, O soul of peace, O soul of total satisfaction. Irji'i ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiyah. You're gonna come back to your Lord. You are pleased with His qadr, with His predestined fate, and mardiyah, Allah is pleased unto you. So if you keep remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the status of dhikr, istighfar, salat on the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you reach this level of an-nafsul mutma'inna. And anyone who believes in Allah, you know, at the end when we die, when we go to your grave, what will be the main thing that will happen there? The angels will come and will ask you what? Three questions. That's it. It's all about these three questions. Man Rabbuk? Who is your Lord? Ma Dinuk? What is your faith? ماذا كنت تقول في محمد? What is that you are going to say about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Whoever knew about Muhammad and to follow him. So anyone with faith in Allah is mutma'in, inshaAllah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمِ Those who believe and did not scratch their faith with aggression. Here means shirk. They did not worship someone else with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنِ Those shall enjoy the safety, security. مطمئن. أمن مطمئن. They come from the same origin. Right? الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ Those who believe and their hearts feels the tranquility and the remembrance of Allah. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ For indeed in the remembrance of Allah your heart feels what? Peace. There is nothing you can measure the peace of mind, the tranquility of heart, when you finish your Maghrib prayer or Fajr prayer and you sit down and you make dhikr lillah. That moment of dhikr, of ibadah, what is it worth? People are putting so much money for all these opioids and, you know, drugs to get, you know, some headaches taken out from their systems. You have it all in dhikr lillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So back to at-taqwa. How much time do we have? I don't have a clock here. What time is Maghrib here? Okay, we have good 8:30. Oh, we have good time. All right. We are talking about at-taqwa. We are talking about three. So how that relates to the term Allah? How could you be unsure about that? He is too high. He is of too might that none of your intellect and mind can really catch his real entity subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار. You cannot encompass him subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter how much you think about God, you cannot imagine him. He is beyond your ability to imagine subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is where no brain, no mind can rise to have an idea of what really God is look alike. You only have about God his names and attributes subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Khaliq, Al-Raziq, Al-Bari, Al-Musawwir, you know, the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this is where you stop and you say, my limit is here. I cannot encompass. If I cannot encompass one ni'mah, I mean, up till now, even medicine, people cannot explain. Like, they can explain the effects of it or how it originates. But how it functions, how it comes, people still don't know. A lot of diseases, we have no idea how it is. I mean, talk about your own self. What is anger? You can only describe how anger affects you. But what is anger? What is love? You can only describe how you feel. But what is it originally? You have no idea. I mean, what is your soul? وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ. If you are not able to identify matters among yourself, how can you describe the true entity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his might? لَا تُدْرِكُهُ الْأَبْصَارِ وَهُوَ يُدْرِكُ الْأَبْصَارِ. He is beyond. So Allah means the Lord that is beyond your imagination to encompass him in his full, you know, attributes and names subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said, for example, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا. Who knows the ayah? نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا, right? وَإِن تَعُدُّوا. Al-Ad in Arabic, to count. Right? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So Allah is saying, if you count one blessing, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ, one blessing. Hearing, sight, children, whatever, you know, any blessing you have. If you are to count one ni'mah of Allah, la tuhsuha. What is ihsa? Senses. You can count, but you cannot encompass. You cannot understand the full extent of ni'amullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even one. Al-ihsa ghayr al-ad. Al-ihsa to encompass. Ihsa is 1, 2, 3, 4, but I mean, Lad is 1, 2, 3, 4, but Ihsa is 1. His name is this. His mother's name is that. His father's name is that. He's born on that day. His blood, you know, A plus. He is 5'7". He is every single detail about him, that's Ihsa. Allah is telling us what? You can only count. Al-Ihsa, encompassing ni'am, is not in your capacity. You don't have the ability to be able to get even close to one ni'mah. If you cannot even encompass ni'amullah, how can you encompass Allah? That's out of the question. Your status is to be in praise and submission to him subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise him. So that is the first level of at-taqwa. Alzamahum kalimata at-taqwa la ilaha illallah. If you need to be among al-muttaqeen, it means what? You have to have La ilaha illallah with you. Without La ilaha illallah, you are not included among al-muttaqin. The second level, they say, fi'lul ma'mur wa tarkul mahzur. To do what is being told to be done in revelation, and to keep away from that which you are told not to do. What is the first sin Evan practiced? Huh? Kidib? No. Qatil? No. Ever, not just humans and all that which exists. Ashirk. The first sin was from Iblis. He did not respond to Allah's order. He told him, Usjud li Adam. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ. So the first sin was, he rejected فِعْلِ الْمَأْمُورِ. He did not respond to what he was supposed to do, right? The second sin was tarkul mahdhur, tarkul, you know, fi'lul mahdhur. He acted on that which he was not supposed to do, which is Adam. What did he do? He was told not to eat from the tree and he ate from it. When we are talking about this level of taqwa, this is the main level. The first one enters you in Islam, enters you in the world of taqwa. The second one is people going up and down. Your thermometer goes up and down. And let me share with you some thoughts about the type of sins that you need to be aware of. I'm going to talk about the categories of sins. Which is the most favored or the most famous category of sin that we know about? Any ideas? Sins are generally either saga'ir or kaba'ir. Small sins or major sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشِ إِلَّا اللَّمَمْ. Those who keep away from the major sins, but they might fall into the small ones, the lamam. This is one category. The Prophet said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, الصلوات الخمس في اليوم والجمعة إلى الجمعة ورمضان إلى رمضان مكفرات لما بينهن من الذنوب إذا اجتنبت الكبائر. You pray your five times daily prayers. You pray your Jum'ah. You fast Ramadan. And it will take care of all your small sins except for the major ones. The major ones need what? Tawbah. You need Tawbah for everything. But you need to identify the major sin and say, Ya Rabb, Astaghfirullah, I repent. And if it has an issue with other people, you have to go clear it with other people too. And major sins, in simple definition, anything that Allah promised punishment is major sin. So lying, cheating, killing someone, drinking wine, you know, gambling, you know, all this bad stuff. This is one category that the major sins, clear yourself from it and then you are safe. That's one category. The second category, we call it هناك ذنوب مقتصرة وذنوب متعدية. There are sins that are limited and there are sins that expand and spreads. So secure first that you're not falling into kaba'ir. Secure second that if you are to do a sin, make sure that it is limited, it is not what? Expanding and spreading. For the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says what? كل أمتي معافا إلا المجاهرون. Everyone will be safe at the day of judgment except those who take their sins in public. If you want to drink wine to yourself in closed doors, it's a major sin. But then you can add to it more if you take it in public and you drink it in public. Why? Because you're not just doing the major sin to yourself now, you are promoting it outside. You are making it part of the norm. So in that perspective, you are crossing more boundaries. It is not just that you are doing a sin. It might be major or minor. But now you are taking it into what? Another level. That you are spreading it around. And the Prophet says, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that people who make their sins in secret, fearing people or fearing Allah or feeling Allah through people, whatever, it's about still there's some haya in them. There's still some, you know, shyness or embarrassment into them. But people who take it outside or promote it, they have went too far. The third category that you need to pay attention to, there's a sin of ma'asiyah that you do it as a bad act. And there's a sin of bid'ah in deen that you promote a different version of deen that Allah did not reveal. You know, it's different between drinking wine and saying la hawla la quwwata illa billah, you know, I'm doing a sin, or between going and saying wine is not haram. Who said it's haram? And do we have people say that? Oh yes. There are people arguing now saying Allah did not prohibit wine. Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ means keep away from it. It did not say don't drink it. We have people saying that now. These people who have no clue of language, who have no clue of Sharia, they don't know that the term فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ is more strong than the term don't eat it. Don't eat it, pork is haram to consume. But if you touch it, it's najis, you have to wash. But it's not haram to touch it. It's not haram to touch a pig. It's not. But if you touch it, you have to wash your hands. But it's haram to eat. Wine, you have to keep away from it. Don't even come close to it. It's not just not drinking. You cannot sit on a table where wine is being served. You cannot sell wine. You cannot sell grapes that will be made wine. لعن الله حامين, the Prophet made curses like 10 different types of people who are doing with wine. So those people who are changing deen, there are people now in the business of introducing a different version of Islam. They want to customize Islam into, and they call it, you know, different names. So now they call wine like spirit drinks. They just want to justify the methodology. They call adultery art. You know, if someone is naked and doing haram, oh, this is art. They change definitions, they change names. And that's how the way it is. So, incense, there are categories. How much time do we have here? Still 15 minutes. Barakah. We're going to take questions now. Yeah, inshallah. So I'll give you like 10 minutes for questions. So in this categories of sins, people go up and what? And down. You need to make sure that your sins are not in changing deen. You need to make sure that your sins are not promoting haram to others. You need to make sure that your sins are not major sins. If you secure these through, you are on the track of a taqwa that it could be safe, inshallah ta'ala. The last level of taqwa that I will finish with, Imam al-Ghazali, rahimahullah, says, Hujjatul Islam, أَلَّا يَشْغَلَ سِرَّكَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This is a high level, in which, if we had time, we have talked, he had different types of fasting. صوم العموم صوم الخصوص وصوم خصوص الخصوص, the chosen among the chosen. He said التقوى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Be conscious of taqwa towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the perfect haqq. Haqq in the raw, perfect status. What was that term that he was referring to, rahimahullah? He said, أَلَّا يَشْغَلَ سِرَّكَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. That inside, you are with God always. It doesn't matter outside where you are at. You could be at work, you could be at home, you could be at business, you could be in the plane, you could be on a boat, you could be on earth, you could be in space. But inside, you are with Allah all the time. And then he quoted the verse in the Quran al-Kareem. قُلِ اللَّهِ. Say Allah. ثُمَّ ذَرْهُمْ فِي خَوْضِهِمْ يَلْعَبُونَ. And let everyone be busy with their nonsense. Everything other than Allah is nonsense. Or anything that goes under that term. So the highest level of taqwa, that consciously within, constantly you are with God. And this is where I want to finish with this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A person came to him, a sahabi, and he was to travel. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, give me an advice. I am traveling, so what do you advise me? He said, اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتُ. Wherever you are, have taqwa of Allah. And then he said, وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةَ الْحَسَنَةَ تَمْحُهَا. Follow every sin with a good deed, you will erase it. وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ. And deal with people in good manners. SubhanAllah, this hadith is so rich. First, if you look at the three statements, the first one between you and God, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ. The second one between you and yourself, if you do a sin, do a good deed. And the third one between you and people, خالق الناس, treat people with the manners that they are properly. The first one, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتِ. Wherever you are, you should be conscious of God. This is what we call al-muraqabah. To feel that Allah is looking at you. And if you are in that status, then you are in the status of taqwa. But I want to take you to a different level. A man by the name of Nuh ibn Maryam. He was a rich man. He had a beautiful daughter who is faqiha. She has fiqh. And he had a slave. His name is Mubarak. At that time they used to have slaves. He bought a land. He told him to go guard it and take care of the trees and the plants. So he goes a few months. And that man, Nuh, went to go sit in the garden and have some good time. He said, bring me one rumana. Rumman, pomegranates, the fruit. So he brings him one, and he opens it, and it's not ripe yet. It's still green. He said, man, go get me another good one. So he goes and gets another one, and it's also green, not ripe yet. He said, what kind of guard you are? I kept you here for 6-7 months, and you can't even tell me which one is ripe from one is not ripe. He said, you did not give me the permission to eat. You just told me to guard it. He said, you stayed all this time, you didn't even taste one fruit? He said, no. Look at us now, we go to Jewel and we taste every single piece of thing, tasting on the way around. So this man was so impressed by his deen because muraqabah. He felt that Allah is looking at him, so he didn't touch. He said, I have a daughter that I want to marry. Whom do you think I should marry her to? He said, Arab before Islam, they used to marry because of the line of family. It still kicks in us now. The first question is, bint mean, who is the parents? That's the first thing that comes to the mind. And the Jews used to marry for financial means. And the Christians, they used to marry for looks. But Muslims used to marry for deen and taqwa. So he went to his daughter and he said, I have this slave that I'm very amazed by his deen. If I free him, would you marry him? She said, would you accept him for me? He said, yes. She said, I will marry him. So he went, he freed him, and he had him marry his daughter, and they had a son called Abdullah. Now, Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak became one of the very famous scholars in our history. Muhaddith, faqih, zahid. He was a person of hadith. He was a person of fiqh. He was a person of zuhud, righteousness. One of the things that Abdullah ibn al-Mubarak, the son of these two of this marriage, he used to stay home doing hadith, writing and studying and whatever. So the people used to tell him, "Ala tastawhish? Don't you feel kind of weird alone, uncomfortable? He said, how could I feel alone and I am with the Prophet and his Sahaba? Now he could have meant literally that he feels literally he is with the Sahaba and the Prophet as much as he is studying about them. Or he might have meant that I am busy narrating their ahadith and whatever, so I feel I am with them. This is a level of ihsan which is higher than al-muraqabah. The ihsan in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, answering Jibreel, مَا الْإِحْسَانَ أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as if you see Him. So at-taqwa leads you to a form of al-muraqabah, leads you to a form of al-ihsan. You feel you as if you are in the presence of God whenever you are doing acts of worship. That's a total different discussion and long talk to talk, but I want to leave the last few minutes if you have any questions on the subject or anything else that you have in mind. I want to thank all of you who came and joined us in this blessed evening, inshallah. Okay, Jazakumullah khair, guys. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.